On this week's Movie Hilo, we're talking Zoltar, disgusting beluga caviar, and Heart and Soul on a Walking Piano. Your wish is granted. This is Penny Marshall's Big.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another episode of Movie Hilo, a podcast discussing the best and worst. A podcast discussing the best and worst that cinema
Sometimes
has to offer.
Sometimes it is disgusting.
I do feel like this podcast is getting more and more disgusting as it goes on. Before we even jump into tonight's movie, we went and saw The Invisible Man this weekend. It was pretty great.
Yeah.
I liked it quite a bit.
Yeah. I mean, we saw it kind of late, so I kept dozing off and I kept saying, like, I kept waking up at all the boo scare moments, but there were some good ones.
It's just a cool take on it, and I really like what they did with it, and it was actually legitimately creepy. And her performance was killer. What are you doing?
I'm looking on IMDb, but there you go. Here's one that looks up your alley. The Invisible Maniac. There you go, honey.
Damn. I've never seen that, but we should check that out.
An outrageous lesson in physics and physiques.
We should, I feel like that could make it onto the podcast at some point. So anyways, for this week, the movie we're talking about is actually a classic film, Big, directed by Penny Marshall, released on June 3rd, 1988. This is a high episode, says who? The consensus at IMDb has rated this a 7.3, which I'm actually surprised it's that low. I'm surprised it's not higher. It's not in like the 8 somewhere. But it's got a 97% rating on Rotten Tomatoes. It was nominated for 2 Oscars, nominated for 2 Golden Globes, one of which it won, which was Tom Hanks for Best Actor. He was nominated actually for the Oscar too for this movie.
And he didn't get it for the Oscar.
Didn't get the Oscar, but he got
the
Golden Globe.
Who got
the
Oscar over him for this?
I don't know. It's a good question. I didn't. That my research was limited to that.
What was it? Dirty Dancing.
I don't know. I'm not sure. But the classic coming of age story of statutory rape of a 13-year-old boy. It's what a great time at the movies.
Well, it's a lot of fun. It's a classic, and I'm surprised, like you said, that it didn't have a better score on Rotten Tomatoes.
No, it's got a great score on Rotten Tomatoes.
It's IMDb.
IMDb. I mean, I guess that's where it really separates the men from the boys. Anybody can vote on IMDb, and some people are just kind of cynical assholes. But it's a movie of the 80s. It's a product of its time. I mean, this movie is like patently 80s. It's very much like a time capsule when you watch this film as to how 80s it really is, which is part of what makes it awesome, especially for people who came up in the 80s and 90s. It's like a nice dose of nostalgia.
Absolutely.
Why don't you do a synopsis for us?
Joshua Baskin is your typical 12-year-old boy. He spends the majority of his time hanging out with his best friend Billy, rides his bike, plays computer video games, and doesn't have the slightest idea of what to say when he's around a pretty girl. After suffering the indignity of not being tall enough to get on a ride at the carnival, Josh uses the mystical Zoltar machine to make a callous wish in order to be big. The unintended consequence renders Josh's transformation into a 30-year-old man overnight. Josh must now track down Zoltar to wish himself back, or remain an ill-equipped man-child for the rest of his days. Will Josh be able to regain his youth, or be sucked into the adult world for good?
Nice. Nicely done. I like the way you read a synopsis. You have all of the moves up and down the scale of emotion.
Baby, I got all the moves and you don't even know.
So first of all, it is a classic movie. It's a great film. I don't even think that's up for debate. But I think this is one of those movies that's very fascinating. There's a certain amount of movies that mean something to you when you're a kid when you see them and mean something to you when you're an adult. I mean, this is a movie that for all intents and purposes is meant to be watched for children. It's a PG movie, technically, even though there's a fuck in it, which is kind of surprising.
Oh shit.
In the era of PG-13 movies. But it's a movie that's made for kids, but also plays on an adult level. So it's one of those movies that I feel like when you watch it as a kid, it kind of means one thing to you versus when you watch it as an adult, it kind of means another thing to you. So I posted this on Instagram the other night when I happened to catch it on HBO. And I think
was it a coincidence when you were supposed to watch it and then it was on HBO?
Well, it was on HBO and I
ended up, we had already planned to do a thing for this. So it's a coincidence that you happened to see it on HBO when we were already going to be doing a podcast about it. That's
right.
Funny.
So, but the...
It's a sign.
The thing that I happened to post this on Instagram, the 3 lessons learned from Big watching it as an adult. Lesson number 1, you become an adult all too quickly. Number 2, people who know nothing can somehow feel upwards. And number three, sex turns you into a giant asshole.
Feel upwards, exactly. I know. It's like, it is all too convenient how he gets that job and everything. It's like, really? It's like, oh, George Washington. Oh, I went to the... It's like probably George Washington Middle School, but it's like
right, exactly.
George Washington University or whatever.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, I'm a George Washington man too.
Yeah, and it's... and. There, I mean, obviously, there's a level of...
Don't you work for me? Are you here with your kids or something? No.
There's a whole level of convenience of things that just have to...
It's like if you were an actual CEO and you ran into this shit, you probably wouldn't be so inspired and like, oh, wow, look, he's just trying to really get in on the perspective of a child from their point of view. Like,
but it's also like...
It's like, wow, this guy's a little bit crazy.
Yeah, but it's also a toy company. It's like wish fulfillment. It's like the greatest job that a kid could get is to work for... a toy company.
It's kind of like in Home Alone where it's like you get the hotel suite and I think, of course, yeah, I know you get to have ice cream and pizza, whatever the fuck you want.
It's just one of these things where, you know, that, I mean, all of that stuff has to come from a level of suspending disbelief that, okay, right. We're going to go with it for the sake of the story. I got a lot of highs written down. I think the first place to start, which is going to, again, the most obvious place to start in terms of highs for this movie is the performance by Tom Hanks.
Right. Obviously, Tom Hanks' performance is legendary in this role.
And it's one of those things where the thing that makes it so great is that, and this is stating the obvious as far as I'm concerned, but the thing that makes it so great is the fact that he's consistently convincing as a 12-year-old boy.
Well, right, because Tom Hanks has always been, honestly, one of the things that I think he's been typecast as throughout his career, even after Forrest Gump, is the boy next door. He's very clean-cut, good-natured. Like, you think of Tom Hanks, you think of the good guy. You think of the guy that would hold the door open for your grandmother and help her push in her chair, like, has manners and is respectful and polite and charming. And, like, that's what you think of when you think of Tom Hanks. So it makes sense, you know, based on his persona and his image of what he plays in movies, that he would play this role. Because he's very boyish in a lot of his charms.
But, like, has to actually be, like, childish.
Right.
Like, to his... But, like, in a way that isn't... I don't know how, like, the balance of what he's doing in the movie is really good because
it's authentic.
It just feels like he really behaves as
like a 12-year-old trapped in a 12-year-old body.
Like even down to like his mannerisms, though, his body language. The scene that I wrote down that I think is like the first one that really sells it is when they go to the St. James Motel and he has to stay there by himself, mm-hmm. and you see him like in the room all by himself and he doesn't know what to do with himself and he's kind of like sitting down in the chair and the way his hands are, mm-hmm. and then he gets scared because he's hearing the people arguing, mm-hmm. and the gunshots and he moves.
It's very believable.
You just look, it's like, oh, you just buy that he's a little kid, and the whole thing throughout the movie is it's so consistent that you always believe that he's really a kid in a man's body. He's the way he's behaving and the way that... he's crafting the performance is really authentic to, you know, he's tapped into his inner child in this movie 100%. I think I was reading about how they talked about how they would keep David Moscow, who was the kid who played young Josh in the movie. They
the
would
one
keep
that looks
him.
Like the kid from That Thing You Do.
He does. He does look like Thomas Everest. Is that his name?
I don't know, looks like the guy that ends up being in That Thing You Do, which you said Rita Wilson is the one that convinced him to cast him because you look like a younger, he looks like a younger you.
Yeah, that's
But he was going to cast him aside. And then it's like, no, actually, his wife, Rita Wilson, said that he looks a lot like a younger version of you, so you should cast
him. It's a weird connection.
But he looks like a younger version of that actor.
He does. Like the drummer from That Thing You Do. He really does. They would keep that kid, David Moscow, they would keep him on set for scenes that he wasn't even in. And what they would do is they would let him perform the scene and Tom Hanks would watch. And then they would, you know, then he would do the scene kind of almost imitating the behavior of that kid. So he was looking for the authenticity of like, how would a 12-year-old act in this scene? Do you know what I'm trying to say? Is that
right.
There would be scenes that he wasn't in that Tom Hanks is like in, and they would play the scene out with the kid there. Tom
so
Hanks would watch the
be,
kid
right.
and then he would go and perform the scene
right,
afterwards,
right.
Which I think is kind of cool. That's like
it's
an interesting way to approach it. So the Zoltar machine, we should talk about the Zoltar for a second, mm-hmm. because one of the things I think is really cool about the movie, it does a cool thing where it doesn't skimp on setting up the movie and like getting you to understand the characters and the scenario, but it moves pretty quickly. I mean, like Tom Hanks, like this kid is turned into Tom Hanks by like minute 10 of this movie.
Mm-hmm.
We're already into like, okay, boom, he's transformed and now he's an adult and we're in the thick of it. Well, that's the thing. I even think the wish in and of itself is kind of funny because he's the wish comes from the fact that he can't get on the carnival ride. He's too small And it's like it's humiliating because he's standing next to this girl that he likes, mm-hmm. and he's too short to get on the friggin' carnival ride. So he makes the wish to be big, which is up for interpretation, right? I think he means he could have easily taller. He could have easily just taller. Said, "I wish to be taller." Right? Exactly. He could have just ski-loaded his way into a completely different plot if he just changed the wording of his wish. I guess if he just wished to be taller. I wish I was a little bit taller. I wish I was a baller. I wish I had a girl who looked good. I would call her.
Wish I had a rabbit in a hat with a bat. I wish I could be taller, not necessarily big, like old, but
I think Zoltar was kind of fucking with 30. Him a little bit. So real quick though, two funny things that I always think about. Well, not even really, but one of my a great Family Guy bit. There's another one we'll reference later, but a great Family Guy bit that I always think of is, I remember there's an episode of Family Guy where Stewie, there's like a cutaway where Stewie goes to the Zoltar machine and he's like, I wish I was big. And then like the Zoltar machine gives him the thing and it says, I wish I could weigh people.
I wish I could weigh people.
Yeah. Like, I wish I was a scale. But anyways, the Zoltar kind of became like a classic thing. I mean, that's now you see that. I mean, there was always, I feel like the Zoltar was invented for this movie, but you've always seen something like that at a carnival. And now like, you would see, after Big came out, you'd see Zoltars everywhere. It was like a thing.
I vaguely know of it, and I don't know if I remember that it was named Zoltar, but I remember being in arcades plenty of times because I have older brothers and like seeing the fortune teller thing that like, it looked just like that. It was like the stupid little fucking fortune teller inside a box where, you know, you put in a coin and it tells you your fortune, which usually came in the place of a card. It was usually a card, and you have one that you saved in your wallet even that you got from good times back in the day. Mm-hmm. It was a fortune telling machine. I mean, it's that idea. It's so chintzy, but it's like, what if it actually came true? I mean, look, all this, and then you find out it's unplugged. Like, ooh, it's why is it working then? It must be, you know, some sort of magic. And, you know, that's the whole premise of the movie.
So another one I wrote down was, I think the script is another big high for the movie. The script was written by Gary Ross and Ann Spielberg. Gary Ross
is that Steven Spielberg's wife?
It's Steven Spielberg's sister.
Oh.
She was one of the, she was the co-writer. Let me just make sure I got that right. Yeah, Gary Ross and Ann Spielberg. Gary Ross would eventually go on to write and direct Pleasantville. He actually became like a big writer after this, but I think this was like his first feature script. And then Ann Spielberg was Steven Spielberg's sister who co-wrote the movie. And the script is great because, it does two things that I think are really important as far as like when you're making a movie like this. It's funny. It's consistently funny. And even like, you know, 30-ish years later, it's still a really funny movie. Mm. But the thing that it really does well is it does a really good job of balancing the fantasy element of the story with like some of the deeper meanings to the movie. It's got it strikes that balance fairly well where, you know, you're watching it and you're just enjoying it on this level of like it's a pure fantasy. It's a little kid who makes a wish and turns into an adult, mm-hmm. and the hijinks that ensue. But at the same time, it's kind of telling a deeper story. Like I was saying earlier, when you watch this movie as a kid versus when you watch it as an adult. When I was a kid, the message I got from the movie was like, don't be in such a big rush to grow up. Mm. Right. And then you watch it as an adult and the message kind of feels like it's, don't lose the inner child that's inside you.
A little bit of both, right.
You know, so it does that kind of.
Well, it's like The Little Prince by Antoine de Saint-Exupéry.
Yes, yeah.
It's a very similar idea.
Yeah.
Which is why it's a beautiful story.
Yeah, but it's just, it does a good thing of not being up its own ass with the message that's like hitting you in the face. I think it comes right up to the line of, you know, there's like the scenes at the end when he's walking back in his old neighborhood and he's looking at the, you know, he's seeing all the kids and he throws the ball back and that he's starting to realize that he is longing for the part of his life that he didn't get to live.
Mm-hmm. His lost youth.
It comes right up to the line of like maybe being a little too on the nose, but mm-hmm. it does a good job of being able to have fun while have a message underneath so that the fun feels more earned because there's something underneath it.
Yeah,
it's not
absolutely.
Just Tom Hanks doing fart jokes as a I'm 30, but I'm really 12 type of thing. But, you know, having something underneath it to support it while not, like I said, getting up its own ass with the message and still being able to have fun and play on that level. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a nice balance of being able to be fun and have a message at the same time.
And if there's anything about it that seems a little bit cheesy or corny, I mean, it's like you have to think about Sign of the Times. I mean, this is the late 80s and it's coming out this kind of movie. So there's definitely going to be things about it that are dated or feel a little bit cheesy. But like,
well, there were tons.
Because of the time, you know, it's done. It's like it doesn't feel overly that way.
And the 80s was kind of like ripe with these
John Hughes movies,
but not even that, like these body swap movies. Like there were tons of them at that time.
The
there
Parent
was
Trap.
And the not the Parent Trap. You're thinking of Freaky Friday. There was one with Judge Reinhold and I think Fred Savage. And I forget what the hell that one was called. Freaky Friday, which I think might have been even in the 70s, but maybe it was like the late 70s, early 80s. There was one with Dudley Moore. I really can't even remember the titles of them, but I just remember the 80s was like rife with these body swap movies. They were like kind of a thing that was happening at that time. And even though this isn't, I mean, this is sort of a body swap movie in a weird way. He doesn't necessarily swap with another person, but he transforms into an older man overnight. And this is the one that I think had the most resonance with an audience because of the fact that there was a real kind of good story underneath it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's fun. It's charming. It's endearing. It's fucking Tom Hanks. I mean, he's like the male version of Julia Roberts or whatever, like America's Sweetheart. Like, but the male version. I mean, it's Tom Hanks. You know what I mean?
Do you have a favorite Tom Hanks performance?
Probably Forrest Gump. I mean, who didn't grow up loving that movie?
Well, he also, the thing about him, I think, is for a long time, at least in this part of the 80s, was kind of doing like he came off of Bosom Buddies, which was like an 80s TV show. He was kind of doing like the comedy shtick. He was doing like Bachelor Party. He was doing, I think, Turner and Hooch, which may have came after this. But I think this was like one of the first movies where people were starting to see that he had like a bit of a range. Because he hadn't really done anything dramatic up to this point. Nothing like really dramatic. And then, of course, now this is 1988. In 1993, he actually wins his first Oscar for Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. You're starting to see him in this movie transitioning into a more serious, even though he's doing comedy here, you're seeing that he's got like this range that he can, you know, eventually build
Streets
on.
Of Philadelphia.
I always think of the South Park. Sandwiches.
Name is Jared. Jared lost weight in Subway nights, cold and alone. No one left to call his home.
Desensitized to violence, eating Oreos.
So that was when he goes to the St. James Motel. Yeah. And I think,
right, and then it shows like later, he's like, in the beginning, he's so like freaked out and he's crying. He thinks he has a gunshot and he's scared and all that. And then later it's like he's eating Oreos, he has gunshots, he doesn't even fucking care, he's unfazed.
And I think that's kind of cool because that speaks to the
hardening, he's toughening up.
But not even that, just how kids are adaptable, how that first night he's there, it's an unfamiliar place and it's scary to him and it's freaking him out. And he's playing it like a scared kid who's not, or maybe it's
a testament to him toughening up, less to how adaptable kids can be and more about that he's toughening up. He's used to being in that surrounding now.
It's not new or scary to him anymore. Plus, he's also sitting there eating Oreos and watching TV without mom coming in and telling him it's time to go to bed. It's kind of like, ah, fuck it. I don't care about the shit
actually,
going on
yeah,
outside.
No, because that happens at the beginning of the movie is that the mom comes in and it's time for bed. But
And he has to share his bed with his, this, or his room with his baby sister.
Yeah, that's
that was
what happens
weird.
When you don't grow up with a lot of money.
Damn. One thing I thought was really, so this is, and you know, obviously you and I are big Sopranos fans, like a bit, I just wrote this down as soon as I saw it, because it's like, it almost escapes me when I think
Robert
back on
Loggia?
It, that you got Feach LaMana and Vin Mikasian.
Robert Loggia.
Loggia. That's.
Look, it's Robert Loggia. Oh, is that Robert Loggia?
That's the other Family Guy joke I wanted to reference when they're doing the thing, like there's nothing worse than being stuck and a bank teller line behind Robert Loggia, and then it cuts to him and he's like, "Hi, I'm Robert Loggia.
Can you spell that for me?"
Certainly. That's Robert Loggia. R as in Robert Loggia. O as in, oh my God, it's Robert Loggia. B as in, by God, that's Robert Loggia. E as in, everybody loves Robert Loggia. R as in Robert Loggia. T as in, Tim, look over there, it's Robert Loggia. Space. L as in look, it's Robert Loggia.
But no, you got Feach LaMana and Vin Mikasian in the form of Robert Loggia and John Hurd, rest in peace. Mm-hmm. together.
Oh, he's dead now?
He died. He died a couple years ago.
John Hurd?
John Hurd, yeah.
The guy that plays Kevin McAllister's dad?
You think of two people. You think of two people when you think of John Hurd. You either think of Kevin McAllister's dad or you think of the crooked cop who sold out Big Pussy and gave Big Pussy to Tony Soprano as an informant. Yeah. But it's so cool just seeing Fichelon and Vin McKaysey. Yeah. So the rest of this episode, with much love and respect to John Hurd, for the rest of this episode, anytime I reference John Hurd, I'm going to be calling him Vin McKaysey because that's who he is to me.
The Sopranos. Okay, yeah. Got it.
So I just loved seeing those two together. There's one scene that this is like one of those random things that I just wrote down because it just like cracks. It's one of those, I've seen this movie so many times, but this one small idiosyncratic thing, every time I see this movie, it just cracks me up. The scene where Tom Hanks and Vin McKaysey are playing racquetball, and like it's like after he's kind of gotten with the
right his girlfriend. That's his piece of ass now, it's
like a challenge, like the two of them. So they're playing racquetball, and Tom Hanks is like almost beating him at one point, and he serves, and he calls it. Tom Hanks is like, oh, it's under the line. You said it's under the line. It's my serve, and they get into this big fight, and it becomes this whole thing where, you know, Tom Hanks is just trying to keep the ball away from him, mm-hmm. but there's this you see, like, as they're fighting like little kids, mm-hmm. you know, and Tom Hanks is a little kid, and mm-hmm. Vin McKaysey's acting like a little kid, because that's how we all are.
Tom Hanks is egging him on.
You know, and you're starting to see, like, this crowd gather to watch them having this ridiculous fight. This is this great line where it's off camera as you're watching all of the people gathering, but you just hear Tom Hanks going, "This guy cheats! He's a cheater! This guy cheats!
Cheater!
Give me the ball!
I do not cheat!
This guy cheats!
Give me the ball!
Cheats!"
Every time I see it in the movie, it just cracks me up.
It's funny.
All right, why don't we take a quick break? We'll come back. We'll do some more highs, and if there are any lows,
okay.
Do you have any lows for this movie?
I have not big ones.
I got. Well, this will be funny. This will be interesting.
Not a lot, but
yeah. It's hard. It's this one's hard.
Even the movies that we've done that have been low so far, I still have more highs. Yeah. There's still more things I can find about them, even if they're shit movies that are endearing.
I've noticed that about you. I guess
I'm more of a half.
You have a sunnier. Yeah, you have a sunnier disposition when it comes to even stuff that's garbage.
Not about everything in life, maybe with movies.
Movies at least. All right, we'll be right back, and we'll be back in a few.
I met a girlfriend, a Triscuit. She said a Triscuit, a biscuit, ice cream soda, but no, on the top. Who's your leader? Walking down the street, 10 times a week. I stole my mama's credit. I'm cool, I'm hot, suck you in the stomach 3 more times.
So let's talk about some great scenes from the film. I think there's plenty of great slash classic scenes in this movie. I mean, the first one.
Absolutely.
The first one that I think, even if somebody's like vaguely familiar with this film, I think the first thing that anybody thinks of when they think of this movie is the dancing on the walking piano scene.
Right.
In the toy store.
Heart and soul, I fell in love with you, lost control.
You were saying though before that it's like the convenience of the way that he's able.
Well, like of course they both know the song. Well, I mean it's a simple song. So isn't Chopsticks, but like you have to bank on the fact that they both know those simple pieces and how to play them in the same time and like are going to play perfectly. So it's like, oh, of course, like they just both play perfectly.
But no, but you were saying before even like the fact that he wins that he's so childish enough to win the CEO over is a plot convenience versus like the hard boiled or hard nosed CEO versus who Robert Loggia is playing in this, which is that he's just so charmed by Tom Hanks. Mm-hmm. Oh, look at you. You're like a little kid.
Right.
You,
he's so used to being around sycophants that he's not used to somebody who's just genuinely.
Yeah. Like even when they first meet, he literally runs into him and knocks him down. Mm-hmm. And Vin McKaysey,
which had to happen so that when he runs into them in the toy store, you're like, don't you work for me? Right, because otherwise how would he even know him?
But
right.
Vin McKaysey says he's like, oh, like he's
that's
like,
a plot
you just ran into this guy.
I like let's speak about John Lovitz. He finds out how much he makes. He goes,
$187. He's like, I know they screw you, don't they?
I know, damn. It's like, wow, money.
I think it's even funnier. There's a couple of
fucking John Lovitz.
There's a couple.
Oh, if you talk to her, the right ocean spread likes you. Oh, I won't talk to her then or whatever.
He goes, yeah, she'll wrap you in your legs so hard. And he's like, I'll stay away from her.
It's like, what? It's supposed to be a good thing.
Because he's like a little kid. He doesn't.
I know.
Man, that's scary. I don't know about that.
I know.
But the the dancing on the piano thing, it's like, that's a very kind of charming thing. I think production wise, I know that they said that those guys, you know, Robert Lozier and Tom Hanks actually performed that. They had stunt guys or like doubles that were there to be able to do it if they couldn't perform it.
Like,
but
the
they
piano
were,
thing?
Yeah, they were dead set on actually being able to perform
it. They probably had to practice it together.
They probably
bum,
did.
Ba-dum, 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 ba-dum.
It's cool. It's a, it still holds up as a cool scene. Like, it may be cheesy to a certain degree, yeah, but it's kind of like when you watch it, you're like,
it reminds
oh, awesome.
Me, it's like the same level of notoriety as Risky Business and Tom Cruise.
Yeah. Dun, dun, just dun, iconic. Dun, dun, dun,
dun. Bob Seger.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a nice,
it's like one of those scenes.
Music to movie. Like sometimes you, right, when you think of certain songs, like anytime I think it's Stuck in the Middle with You, like, right, boom, I'm in Reservoir Dogs.
Right.
It's one of those things, you think of that song, you immediately think of this movie, mm-hmm, which is cool. And it's just, and it's kind of, it's a nice way to, he ingratiates himself to Macmillan and then is able to move up the ladder where he's just a data entry guy, mm, you know, and now all of a sudden he's the vice president.
I know, that's why it's like, do you have to play with everything? Cut to him playing with everything. Like, I think, yeah, it's so funny.
Yeah. Another classic scene, I think, is the company party scene. When he shows up in that crazy tux.
And he's quintuple dipping his carrot. Yeah.
He's like...
And they're just looking at him like, really? It's like one of those things you just don't do as an adult. You don't fucking triple, quadruple...
But he's doing way worse than that. He's taking like the celery sticks and he's just licking all the cream cheese out of them and then like discarding the celery.
Right, like the way a kid would do.
You know, like I don't
like at
like
our
this
school
part.
When we serve snack and we have oranges, it's like we always have the kids that eat the oranges and then put the fucking peels back into the container where they got. It's like, don't stick your dirty ass peels that you ate the orange off of back into the container where you got the oranges. It's like, that's like the way a kid would eat. That's right. Like the whole joke.
Right. He's
it's like, the, ew, you gotta pick your plate. Like, I don't want this.
The best is when he's
eating little corn.
The baby corns, and he's eating it like corn on the cob.
Yeah.
Apparently that was like an improv,
I believe
from Tom Hanks.
Yeah, but I can picture.
But it's so funny. And then obviously when Penelope, what the hell's her name? Penelope.
The chick in the movie?
Yeah, but what's her
name?
I
don't know what the actress's name is.
When she, what? I just said it a few minutes ago. Elizabeth Perkins. Why am I calling her Penelope?
I don't know.
Jesus Christ.
Penelope Cruz?
When Elizabeth Perkins.
Open your eyes.
Sorry. Do that again. That was good.
Open your eyes.
That's really good.
Losing momentum.
Yeah, I know.
More like choosing fermentum.
There it is. When Elizabeth Perkins.
Yep. Blabbermouth cunt.
It's another Sopranos line. If any of our Sopranos,
one of these days we're
going to
do Sopranos podcast.
Well, no, there's a lot of Sopranos podcasts out there. Props to Potta Bing. I'm a big Potta Bing fan. We definitely, before Many Saints of Newark comes out, we should do a Sopranos month. Where we just like, we'll pick like four seminal episodes.
There are a lot of things I could say right now that I am not going to say.
You never had the makings of a varsity athlete. Let's not go down that rabbit hole because this whole thing can turn into a Sopranos podcast.
What, you're
going like
to have a sleepover? You're going to play Name That Pope?
You don't shit where you eat. And
you
really
definitely
don't
shit
where
I
eat. All right.
We're a hole in your sock.
I know. It's very embarrassing. Then the other part when Elizabeth Perkins shows up and is like, oh, they get this great beluga caviar every time. Every party, and he fucking eats it, and he's freaking out. He's like, he's just like spitting it out. Like, he's like, you got a milkshake?
And she's like, you want to get out of here? Want to go fuck, basically.
Basically. Yeah. So we should talk. That was another.
GTF?
That's another great scene. The sleepover scene.
Mm.
When
you want to sleep over, right?
When they get back to the house, she's like, I don't know if we should do this. And he's like, what do you mean? She's like, stay the night. And he's like, oh, you want to sleep over? I get to be on top.
I know. And she's just confused. Like, do you mean it like I mean it?
But it's so funny because like the way that whole scene plays out is she's expecting one thing. She's expecting like, you know, this guy is going to take advantage of me or she wants.
I'm vulnerable right now. Can't you hear me?
That's, we should talk about that scene too.
In the car.
In the limo. And he's like so psyched to be in a limo.
I know.
Like he's never been in one before and he's just playing with everything. And she's like, stop with the radio. And then he opens up the moon roof and is like running, like sticking his head out in New York City. Like it's such a blast, you know. And then,
Listen to me. I'm really vulnerable right now.
She's like throwing herself at him.
I know.
And he's not picking up on any of the social cues because he's a kid. He has no, which the more you think about that is really creepy. I mean, it's funny for the purposes of the film, but the more you really think about the quote unquote reality of that, it can get a little bit
like if it was actually well, that's shifty. Well, not to fast forward, but like the end of the movie where it's like him and it's like he's back to being a child again. They just look at each other.
Oh,
well, and that's so fucking weird. I'm like, ew, because they're looking at each other like, yeah, baby, when are we gonna do it again? It's like, okay, now he's actually a kid again. Like, and you know he's a kid. He told you he was a kid, and you're looking at him and you can see that he's a child, and you're looking at each other.
When
like,
we were watching that,
you yeah, we're gonna fuck again, aren't we? It's like, this is fucking weird. This is so weird.
When we were watching that, you were just like, oh, this is so creepy.
I know, because it was really bothering like, you. It's like I'm waiting for him to sniff his fingers. Like,
stop. We're not putting that in. Stop.
I mean, at this point in my life, don't play with the. No. I'm really vulnerable right now.
Right on.
You know, I love my job. And.
Eject your seat. He's all like jazzed about the fact that he's in a limo for the first time, and she's trying to talk to him like, I'm vulnerable, aren't you listening to me? And like, they're on two different wavelengths. Yeah. You know, for her it's like, you know, you're gonna come take advantage of me now because this is what happens with most adult men. Yeah. But like in reality he's just excited.
Yeah, he's a kid. He's
taking in all the moments of being at this fancy place and being in this limousine and does the radio work and whatever. I mean, and oh, it's got a moonroof and like it's the luxuries that are interesting to him, like rather than the girl. Like,
and he's not used to any of it. And that's like part of the thing is that like as an adult, as you get older, you start getting used to shit versus everything's like new and exciting and an adventure versus like, oh, she's like, this is the company car. Like I'm driving this all the time. I don't give a shit. It doesn't mean anything to her that they're riding around in a limo. To him, it's like blowing his fucking mind.
Right.
Oh my God, we're in a limo. This is so cool. We can go get
drive. She's the one that said, she's like, I've got a car if you want to get out of here. And it's like, come to find out, yeah, I've got a limo. Like, oh, it's company car.
So it's funny because now they get back to his apartment and like she's ready to ride the D train. She's thinking this is DTF. Where it's going, you know. And he's just like, hey, come check this out. My Pepsi machine, you can just throw a ball at it. It's rigged up. You don't even need quarters. You can get a Coke if you want it. Like, or say Coke or Pepsi, whatever the fuck it is. But then it's like, I got pinball, I got this trampoline, and then it's the whole thing like where they're jumping around on the trampoline. It's like that scene's really funny because it starts out where like he wants her to get on the trampoline and she's looking at it like, oh, is this like part of the foreplay? Like he's like going to pick her up and she's like, ooh, she's like making these weird faces. And then he literally he just pulls her onto the trampoline like he would pull on like his 12-year-old friend, you know, and it's like, all right, let's just jump around. This is and
then you see her getting in touch with her and her child too. It's like they get lost, and that's the whole thing. It's supposed to be like, oh, just be a kid again.
Well, then, but by the end, like when now they're going to bed and he has the bunk beds and she's laying there, like you were the one that was like, oh, look, she's got the jersey on and she's waiting for him.
I know.
And he jumps up into the top bunk and she's like, what? Like this? Really, it's not going down.
He's like, here, take a glow in the dark ring.
And yeah, he's like, doing like, right. pick a hand, and he's like, a glow in the dark compass, and then she's kind of endeared to the fact that, oh, this guy didn't try to make the move on me tonight. Like this guy was just playing with, we were just having fun. We were just being together, and she's not used to that.
Sort
so
of like the innocence of what a first date could be. Or right. Something.
And then I guess, I don't know. Then I guess in a weird way, it kind of makes sense. Like she's an older woman who, I don't know, there's no way to talk about it without it being creepy, but like she's an older woman.
Well, maybe on like some level, she almost knows that he's younger. Like, okay.
Or inexperienced or not.
There's something about this. It almost feels like I'm with a child and it takes you out of the moment. Like, oh.
But that should be a turnoff. I'm sorry. Right. I mean, then again, it's 1988. This is it's a much simpler time. It's not the news headlines of like the teacher who had sex with, you know, the eighth grade student. Like we didn't have that back then. I mean, maybe it was happening, but it certainly wasn't being reported or heard about in the way that it is now.
But I think it's also supposed to be like too, it's like you could fall in love with the sincerity and the innocence, the humility of being a child, or just, you know, that part of it. Like he's so unpretentious compared to all the other, like in some way it's not even just the childlikeness of it, but like the innocence of him is endearing to her. Like she's not used to it, the wholesomeness.
And it's a good counterbalance to her, who has become kind of like this I don't know how to explain it. Like she's become so immersed in the corporate world that she's
probably a little bit cynical.
Yeah, she's become, and this is a way for her to kind of harken back to who she really is inside.
Right.
So it's a nice.
Well, it's like the thing where it's like when he's first introduced into the workplace, it's like her and her boyfriend. What's his name in Sopranos?
Vin McKazian.
Like they're both basically making fun of him, like how goofy he is and dorky and the shit he does, and it's like. She's also kind of interested in him and intrigued like, by him, but like, yeah.
Well, there's the whole scene where she probably wouldn't I don't admit get that. It, where he's like, I don't get it.
And she's kind of like smiling.
And he's looking at it, Vin McKazian's looking at it like, he's fucking with me right now in front of the boss. And what he's really doing is like, I'm a little kid and you're giving me a skyscraper.
That turns into a robot, yeah. So what?
I'm trying to give you an actual suggestion for something that might make the toy more fun for a kid. Mm-hmm. And this guy thinks it's like an attack because he's like throwing all these marketing terms and all of this like, you know, consumer science, research at him. And he's just like, well, what if it was a bug instead of a building? A building's not fun if it's a bug.
A super mother bug. Sorry.
I'm going to have to edit that in there.
I am the super mother bug. I am the super mother bug. Oh my God.
But like, and she's looking at it and then he's all up and then he's afterwards, he's like, I don't get it. He's mm-hmm. like all pissed off. And she's like, he just didn't understand. He was looking for, another, you know, he thinks it's a personal attack versus her being like, he's actually just an interesting guy who's mm-hmm. looking at it like a toy and right. trying to think from a kid's perspective.
His perspective is different than ours.
It's all that stuff rings. And again, this is all due to Tom Hanks's character, like really making it feel like. You understand the whole time you as the audience are watching, you understand it's still little kid Josh in these scenes. It's not grown up guy. It's a kid who's just like, I'm playing with a toy. I'm telling you my honest opinion about it. Like, I don't know anything about marketing research. I just know what I know, which is mm-hmm. that a building is boring. I'd rather it be a bug, you mm-hmm. know? So that stuff is really funny.
Yeah, absolutely.
So other smaller favorite scenes.
I like when his best friend, who goes, I'm 3 months older than you, asshole. Because it's like his friend, who the other little kid who's his friend. And
Billy.
It's like, Billy, yeah, exactly. And then it's like, at one point, he's like, I'm 3 months older than you, asshole. It's like, don't you forget, I'm actually older than you.
You know what I liked about there? And I wrote this down as like part of the, so I thought was kind of cool about their relationship is that their relationship, obviously it changes as time goes on. Mm-hmm. And I thought this was kind of like a, maybe not so subtle, but something that they were purposely trying to do is that their relationship goes from being friends, like Billy's in it. Billy's really the only character that's there trying to help Josh.
But like it goes from being like friends when you're little kids to friends when you're an adult. And but you not, don't but have time for them anymore.
That's very
and
true.
And it's so sad, but it's true. When that's it, it very does. True. You get that. It's like, oh, I can't do it. I gotta go. It's like, why? It's like he doesn't want to say. And then it's like,
I gotta hang out with this chick.
Well, and then like 5 minutes later, it's the scene. She's like, I'm his girlfriend. It's like, oh, it all makes sense now.
Yeah.
It's like, you know.
But even more than that, that's a really good point. But even more than that, I would even say like their relationship goes from being friends to almost in a weird way, kind of like a father. Something where he's kind of like the typical dad who's too wrapped up in his work or his adult life to spend time with the son. Mm-hmm. So like when Billy's showing up and he's like, I got a deadline, I can't talk to you right now. Mm-hmm. It's almost kind of like the way that, you know, a shitty parent mm-hmm. can treat their kid when they're more wrapped up in their career. Cats in the Cradle and the Silver Spoon. Some other favorite scenes, like smaller scenes that I think are really great. I love the job interview when he first does the job interview.
George Washington,
like,
man.
And it's, yeah, that whole thing where he confuses George Washington with like the middle school that he mm-hmm. goes to versus, you mm-hmm. know, the college, the university. When he's like, oh, you missed a couple of numbers on you. Like Billy gives him his locker combination.
Your son can stay here. Yeah, son, wait for me.
Yeah, but then when Billy gives him his...
I know, he's like, you got two numbers missing on your social security. 12.
He just throws out like a random bullshit number.
It is missing.
And then when Elizabeth Perkins first walks in and there's like he's very unsubtly kind of like checking out her ass because she's leaning over the table. And then at one point
he sees her bra or whatever.
Yeah, but he's like, and then like at one point...
Because his friend was just talking about that. If she leans in the right way, you can see her bra or whatever.
And then at one point she's like complaining about the person who works in data entry. He's like, she's getting married. Sometimes she spells the hyphen and he's in the background like, like he's just laughing at everything because it's like funny.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, again, it's just him playing it so perfectly. The bank teller scene, the, you know, $187. And then when the bank teller is asking him, how do you want the denominations? Like, how do you want the money? He has to like go in a huddle with Billy. And they're like talking. He's
three
like,
dime.
Yeah, he's like, I want $87 bills and a $100 bill, like, because it's $100 bill is dope, and they need the ones. Cents. They need all the ones for probably going to the arcade.
Yeah,
or which is awesome. And then the I don't get it scene, which is awesome. Which is we already talked a little bit about it. What else you got?
I'm a child, Susan. Oh well, that's fine. That's just great. Oh yeah. When he finally comes clean with her, and he goes, I'm a child, so she goes, oh, well, fine. That's just great. Just the way she says that line. Her like, reaction. Oh, perfect. Yeah, exactly.
I'm a child, Susan, and I'm not ready for all of this.
Oh, that's fine. That's just great.
Well, you see what happened?
No, I understand. I'm not ready to
make a commitment.
I'm not ready to accept
No, you don't understand. I mean, I'm 13 years old.
Oh, and who isn't?
And then I have my lows.
Oh, you want to do, should we jump into Lowe's?
Algebra. I used to do algebra, and I put fart sounds. Yeah, exactly. I'm like, how can you? Oh, I used to do algebra. It's like, of course you used to do algebra.
Well, there's the scene where like they're at like
and then
the
meanwhile,
party.
It's like, yeah, exactly, the dinner party. It's like, here, I'm going to go upstairs. Now, granted, look at it from the outside perspective. Like, he's a grown man. Yeah, we know he's a kid, but like anyone at that dinner party wouldn't necessarily know that he's a kid. So it's like, this looks like a grown man who's like, here, let me go help your fucking 12-year-old son with his algebra homework in his room. See you later. Like, who the fuck are you going to my son's room? Like,
but if you watch that scene, you see all the guys in that scene are looking at him like, what's this guy's fucking problem?
I know.
And all the women in the scene are like, look at him helping. Oh, he wants to get up from the... And the truth is he's so bored with the dinner party because he's a kid. He's
I
like,
used to do algebra.
I'd rather hang out with this kid and show him algebra because I know a little bit about it. So that kind of rings true in a certain way.
And then the kiss on the forehead, a little lame. Oh, yeah. Doesn't at the end of the movie where he like goes to kiss her and he kisses her on the forehead.
I'm because now she knows. She's like, I can't kiss you anywhere else because you're a kid. And now I know that. And now it's gross.
Wow. Yeah, basically. So, but that was my two lows.
That's it? No other corny. Lows?
Yeah.
All right. So here's my only low. And this is what I think. I think this is the biggest low of the movie as far as I'm concerned. But I think any competent police department would have been able to trace where Tom Hanks was in the movie, right? So as far as his mom is concerned, he's been kidnapped by somebody. Like that's and they go to the extent of like showing the cops are at the house at one point, and you know, she thinks she like when she sees Josh as an adult, she thinks like, what did you do with my son? So she literally thinks that like this Tom Hanks guy is
the guy that took her son.
Kidnapped is her kid. I'm like, any competent police department in the United States of America would have been able to found this guy because he's literally making phone calls to the house.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, he's calling her and being like, hey,
the phone call.
Hey, yeah, they can't. And he's like, okay, he's okay, he's fine. Tell me something that only he would know.
What did I used to sing with you to you as a child? You know, it's like, memories, like the corner of my mind.
And it's like, and then only that, then he's like, literally, it shows him at one point, there's a montage where he's writing her a letter. It's like, they can't trace the USPS mail pattern where the letter originated from, like what any competent police department would have been able to have figured out where the fuck
Tom
Hanks was.
Back in the late 80s, the NYPD wasn't on their game.
And at the same time, I really think that in the end, you know, this is a complaint that's coming from a logical place, but like you, something like this, you have to suspend disbelief. You know, with respect to a movie where a kid makes a magical wish on a carnival game to become a fucking adult.
Actually, another low I did have too was I guess it's more of a, like, I don't know. It's not preferential or wish fulfillment for me. It's like when you watch a movie and certain things are set up, you expect to see them paid off later. And like there are a couple scenes in the beginning of the movie where it's that little blonde girl that he likes. And the last one being at the carnival when he discovers he's too short to ride the ride, and it's humiliating. And that's when he runs off and goes and makes that wish. But it's like you sort of expect that by the end of the movie, that's going to pay off somehow, or he's going to come back with, you know, this real world experience and be like the same kid, but maybe be older, act older or more mature for it. And that's going to win the girl or something, like that something's going to happen where he has that next chance with the girl and it doesn't pay off that way. It's like it just becomes, you know, the relationship he has with the older woman, and then, you know, he goes back to being a kid and they give each other those weird looks that I'm like, it's kind of creepy. Like, hey, baby, we're going to do this again in a few years. I don't know. And then he goes back home, and then that's basically the end of the movie. So it's like, for me, I kind of, I guess, expected and feel a little bit disappointed that they didn't wrap that, even if it's just a tacked on thing. Like, the whole movie isn't about that girl per se, but it's the reason that he wanted to be big in the first place, I suppose.
That's a good point.
So why wouldn't they come back to that, even in some small way, to wrap it up at the end?
So,
you know.
So what I read, and this doesn't necessarily, it kind of goes with what you're saying, but there was originally an alternate ending, which I'm glad they didn't use, because what I'm going to explain to you is kind of a shitty alternate ending. But from what I've read is that there was an alternate ending where they show him back in school at the end of the movie. He's back in school, and there's a new girl who walks in, and it's Elizabeth Perkins. It's
what? But like a younger version of
like
her?
Susan, her name. I think her name is Susan, right? Uh-huh. Where like she went to Zoltar and wished to be little. Or wish to be a kid again. So now at the end, there was going to be a younger version of Elizabeth Perkins coming back to school.
Yeah, that is pretty creepy. It's like, wow, like the whole idea that like, wow, you're just going to be the same age. Like, I know. It's like, you got to really nail the point home.
And not only that, it would have been a shitty,
really want to be the 12-year-old boy.
It would have been a shitty ending. It would have been a shitty ending, but also it would go against, like, there's a great line that she says to him when he says, why don't you come back with me? And she goes, I've already done it, and it's hard enough the first time. You know what I mean? And then she stops, and she goes, you don't know what I mean. And that's enough. That's all you need, is that she's like, I've already had that rite of passage. I don't want to have to do it again.
You've been through this life experience.
Yeah, and like, you need to go back and live it yourself. Mm. So it was a good thing that they didn't do that ending, but I think that would have been more of the bookend of what you're talking about, of like, well, if something sparked him to want to be an adult. That, again, I think the biggest thing for me is that he, you know, this I think is kind of a fundamental misunderstanding about the movie. I've read like summaries of the movie. And people describe this movie as Josh is tired of being a kid. He wants to be an adult. And that's kind of a misrepresentation of what the plot of the movie is. At no point in this movie is Josh being presented as a kid who's so pissed off that he's a kid, not an adult.
Right.
The only thing he wants is to be taller. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's saying, like, if he had literally said, I wish I was taller, it would have been a whole different plot. The whole idea is that he says the wrong thing to Zoltar.
Maybe that Skilo song was based off of this. It was like inspired by
this. It definitely was.
I know, because he never said, I want to be older. He said, I wish to be bigger.
But I'm saying, I think when people think back on this movie, they literally think that like there's a whole early subplot of like Josh being like, oh, I can't drive. I can't buy beer. I can't do this. It's not like that. Josh is happy being a kid. He's actually a happy kid.
But maybe it's more the joke of like, you know, that age old
be careful
thing.
What you wish for.
Exactly. So right. It's like, you wish to be big. Well, you wish to be big. That can mean a lot of things. And what if it means now I wanted to be this, but it took me way past what I even wanted to be. I wanted to be big, but
that's
now
exactly,
I'm big and I'm old and I'm, it's like, shit,
that's
it's
exactly,
way more than I bargained for.
That's exactly right. That's right. And that, I think that's what people, in a weird way, I think people misremember this movie in a weird way. I think people really remember this movie as like, Josh was so sick of being a kid. And he wasn't. He was a perfectly content and happy kid. He just said the wrong thing to the fucking, you know, carnival wizard and ended up being an adult. And that kind of kicks into play the idea the subtext of the movie, which is, you know, don't be in a big rush, man. Like, being a kid's dope. Being an adult in general sucks. So don't be in a big rush to get there. Like, take your time and enjoy your life type of thing. But at any rate, this movie, I think, holds up. I think, like, watching this movie, you know, it's 1988. I think all these years later, it still holds up as a classic because of Tom Hanks's performance, because of the great script, because of how funny it is and how true.
It still rings true to
you. Yeah, it's very true. I mean, even watching it,
Don't lose your dinosaur.
Yeah, don't lose your dinosaur.
And one day my dad said, Bobby, you're 17, it's time to throw childish things aside. And I said, okay, Pop. But he didn't really say that. He said, stop being a fucking dinosaur and get a job.
Remember that part of you that gets excited about stuff, like seeing a cool movie or being in a limousine.
Or having a fucking trampoline in your penthouse.
I mean, if we had a trampoline in this house right now,
we'd be jumping on it.
We didn't even have a podcast. There'd be no reason to have a podcast. We'd be playing on a trampoline every night. That'd be the coolest thing. So I love this flick. This is a great movie. And if you've never seen it, you should check it out.
Two very enthusiastic thumbs up. Yeah, fine, man. Holiday fun.
All right, so we're going to do the coin toss. As always, encourage folks to write into moviehighlow@gmail.com. Send us your high or low recommendations, or hit us up on social media. We Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. Drop us a line. Tell us what or what great movie you've seen and why it's a shitty movie or a great movie. So coin toss for next week. And it's tails.
It's low.
So we are going another classic. Another classic movie. Jaws 4, The Revenge.
Deep Blue Sea. Deep as blue as my head is like a shark's
fin. Deep as blue as my head is like a shark's fin. Deep as blue as my head is like a shark's fin. So thank you guys very much for listening to Movie High Low, a podcast discussing the best and worst of cinema. A podcast discussing the best and worst that cinema has to offer. Wow. You owe me a Coke. I'm Dom.
And this is Dee.
And we'll see you next week with Jaws 4.
Adios.
I'm not sure we should do this yet.
Do what?
Well, I mean, I like you and I want to spend the night with you.
Do you mean sleep over?
Yeah.
Okay. But I get to be on top.